Welcome back guys to another one, and let's finally see my new updated and upgraded Ryzen Judge build now at its 3.0 iteration. So let's go through each component and explain why I chose everything. Then I will do some thermal testing at the end. Let's get the obvious stuff out of the way first, like key parts that I kept from my previous builds. We have the famous A4 case, of course, at the latest 4.1 variant, which means it has the riser card adapter fully compatible with the new PCIe 4.0 bandwidth. I have both colors in black and in silver and decided to go back to black since I think it looks a bit better for me. Plus it kinda blends in with my desk. Then we have the Asetek 645LT AIO, which I covered numerous times on the channel. Then I'm using 3 Noctua 92mm slim fans, which have a massive impact in cooling performance when placed strategically. Also, I've covered these in multiple videos, and I will link everything for you guys. Then the cherry on top is the custom cable set, which is a must buy if you are considering installing the AIO in the A4. Now for the new stuff. CPU wise, I went for the new Ryzen 3 3100, which is a quad-core 8-threaded budget processor, but oh boy does it pack a punch in terms of value and performance. I initially wanted the 3300X since it's so highly praised, but that thing is not in stock for months, at least in the UK. So I got this one until I can upgrade to the upcoming 4th gen CPUs. Plus, while I'm at it, why not review it, which I'll do in a separate video for you guys, and what better way than owning it and doing everything on it per se for a few weeks until I can upgrade. Next is the core of the build, the new ASUS Strix B550i motherboard, which I covered in depth in the separate video where I explain why I chose it for my needs and why I think it's one of the best boards out there for any AMD A4 build. As for RAM, I have this new Team Group Extreme ARGB 16GB DDR4 3600 memory kit. I went for this just because of the looks and that they fit the A4 perfectly, even with the AIO installed. Next is the PSU. I previously had since new the Corsair 600W SFX Gold unit, which was beyond any fault and has served me all of these years and multiple builds. I sold it because I had a good offer on it and basically I have time to kill until I could rebuild my computer again, so no point in keeping it given the circumstances. So I took advantage of the timing and sold it, and then waited for the newly revised 750W Platinum variant. What I mean by new revised version is the fact that they had a bad batch a while ago, so make sure you check the codes if you get one. One of the cool things about the new Platinum series is that now you get as stock the premium braided cable kit from Corsair and even an SFX to ATX bracket. And since I was shopping, I got myself the 750W, just because if I ever need to test any monster GPU and overclocking the CPU and GPU at the same time, I know I am covered. Plus my hunch was right, if we ever manage to physically install a future custom GPU of the new RTX 3090 in the A4, well, the PSU should be enough. Speaking of GPUs, I got myself my favorite custom board, the Strix GTX 1080 from ASUS, just because eBay now is flooded with GPUs on offer since Nvidia basically killed any previous graphics card generations. Why this one in particular? Well, because it's a 3-fan dual slot card and it fits perfectly in the A4. And I mean perfectly, I mean you can't barely fit a sheet of paper in the space left. No point to overspend now and get anything from the older series since I plan to upgrade in the near future to the RTX 3070 Founders Edition, which we all know by now by their statement that it beats the 20 Ti, so yeah. Plus I game at 1080p and for me this GTX 1080 will suffice for some time, and more importantly it's a quiet GPU, hence my main attraction to this specific model. The last component is the storage. Nothing fancy, just something to get me by. We have the new Crucial P2 series at 500GB QLC NAND, so it's a budget drive. I got this one because I'm waiting for the new Samsung 980 series that has the 4.0 bandwidth, but unfortunately Samsung dropped the ball on this one because they have announced that the 980 Pro will have TLC NAND instead of the usual MLC. So making an educated guess, that means the Evos will have QLC. It's not the end of the world since most M.2s will last many years, but it was more of a personal choice in having something overbuilt regarding NAND endurance. Anyway, I can always get an older 970 Pro for the boot drive and keep the front 4.0 port free for any newer M.2s I can find on offer. Okay, so let's build the damn thing already. I covered the build process many times in the past. But as a quick refresh, if you are using the AIO, make sure you remove the two front plastic clips that hold the side panels and the plastic GPU divider, since all of these will interfere with the AIO tubes and the RAT. Then mount the AIO, then the PSU with the cables pre-installed, and then finally install the motherboard to finish this side. Next comes the GPU, and that's it for the overall guide. But now let's get into some very important details and major heads up. Okay, some keen eyes may remember from past videos that this GPU with this specific AIO will not fit because the PCB on this particular graphics card is too long, and thus it will hit the 90 degree tube bends. For reference, the older Asetek 545 LC doesn't have this problem since it doesn't have those 90 degree bends in the first place. So my quick solution for this is to unscrew the riser card so now it can move freely in order to give the GPU some extra slack because now the card resides on top of one of those tubes. Then to make sure that the GPU will not slide off this bend because the riser card doesn't provide a secondary anchor point anymore, I will just secure it into place with some zip ties and cable ties. I know it's not the most elegant solution out there, but I will never see those wires and it gives me peace of mind. This of course needs to last until I will upgrade to the new RTX series, and so far we know that the Founders Edition 3070 will fit perfectly in the A4 since it's on the smaller side and more importantly it uses regular placed fans. I am mentioning this because the Founders Edition 3080s and 3090s, they have those opposing fans which aren't good for vertically mounted GPUs because the top fan will struggle for air, but we will see for sure when some reviews are out. The next tip regards the PSU. This 750 watt model has more ports than the 600 for example, and just make sure you install the GPU cables in the plugs closest to the motherboard because this will give the AIO tubes more room. If not, this will interfere with the cable connectors and there isn't basically enough room in this scenario for everything. Then as you can see, finally we can use the front Type-C connector from the DAN A4 case because this motherboard finally has the front Type-C port present. Now regarding overall cooling. From all of my past video and tests, everything points to the same conclusion that the best possible cooling on the CPU side in the DAN A4 case, you need to have the following combination. The fan on the Asetek needs to be placed as an exhaust, aka taking air from the RAD and pushing it upwards towards the PSU, basically taking fresh air from the bottom of the case through the RAD. Then the case fan needs to exhaust the air out of the case by blowing it outside through the bottom side. This is because the last fan does all the magic, but the size of it comes with a condition. If you have a motherboard that has a medium-sized VRM heatsink, like the one I used to have on the ASUS Strix B450i, then you can install a slim Noctua 120mm fan that will cool everything in one go, like the VRM, chipset area, and even the M.2. This has the best positive impact regarding cool temps because if you use the all-in-one cooler, then the motherboard has no fresh air, no airflow of any kind to go around. But now all of the newer gen boards apparently they have taller heatsinks, almost flush with the rear IO. This means that a slim 120mm fan can't be installed as I managed in my previous videos. So instead, for now I use the third Noctua 92mm slim fan. Since this board already has a quiet VRM mini fan, I know I can position my 92mm fan where it counts the most, which is the chipset and the M.2 area. Again, I had to resort to cable ties until I can figure out a more presentable option, but if it works, I'm happy. And finally, let's see the results. I know my current CPU isn't the former Ryzen 7 3700X in terms of heat output, but at least I overclocked the CPU to 4.4 GHz at 1.25 V, so we can have a general idea. Room temperature is around 23 degrees, and let's start with a noise sample with all of the fans on a silent profile in the ASUS Suit Fan Expert app. Since I don't have the M.2 placed in the front anymore because I explained in the beginning of the video, plus the fact that I already tested this before and we know for a fact that it helps, let's focus on the CPU temps, motherboard and chipset. Okay, sorry for the wall of numbers, but as you can see, that side fan does all the difference in the world. We know that the B550 chipset is more efficient than the X570 that comes with a fan, but in the A4 it still needs the airflow because things will get quite hot and affect everything. So there you have it guys, I would like to mention that as my channel grows, so will this computer, as a testimony for all of your support. So thank you again for watching and please have a look at my Patreon page so I can do even more videos for you guys. See you in the next one. Alex out.